couple true stories there. I was indeed a probation and parole officer for about 11 years. And then also, I did graduate in a class of 26 kids in high school. Anybody else graduate from a school that small here? So coming here to ASU was a big deal. I remember my first class was like 400 kids. I had to sit like right there to make things small. I think you know where I'm coming from. So I appreciate you having me here as a guest. I've known Chris, like he said, probably about 4 years I've been coming here as a guest lecturer. And how that all came about is one of my aspirations is at some point in time I'd like to be an associate professor. I reached out to the dean at the time. She connected me to Chris. And we are closer. We're not long lost brothers, although we look like it. But we have a lot more similarities than just that. We both have a passion for developing great people and great leaders. So I'm really, really honored to be here and spend about a half hour or so with you. And at the end, we'll be happy to answer any questions that you have. So I want to start off with the easiest assignment for you. I'd like to get a sample of responses from you about your current or previous leader. I'd like to, can people just shout out, I'm going to grab about 10, but just one word description of their current or previous leader. Make it clean. This is being recorded, so I want to make sure you don't say anything bad. And if your leader is here, you don't want to make sure you don't say anything bad and offend them. So what's your?
Caring.
Caring. Awesome. That's great. Anybody else? Anybody else have a?
Responsive.
Responsive, okay. This is the leader that you had? Okay. Responsive.
Focused.
Focused. That's some good leaders that you guys are working with. If I can spell here. All right.
Motivated.
Motivated, okay. Way in the back there in the white.
Fair.
What's that?
Fair.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
Fair.
Fair, okay. Let's grab two more. Anybody else have some leaders?
Organized.
Organized, okay.
Demanding.
Organized and demanding. Was that demanding in a good way or a bad way?
Bad way,
okay. That is great. Boy, you guys have been working with some great leaders. Because really the only one that's negative there is just that one, which is really good. Let me show you a stat here that may be of interest to you. The majority of people say they would trust a stranger than their boss. Would you have guessed that? In fact, in this Harvard study, 42% of people say they trust their boss. 58% trust a stranger. 58% say they trust a stranger versus 42% for their boss. That's a significant, significant figure. And what I'd like to do today is just talk about that and how that will impact you and what's the legacy that you'd like to create as a leader. I mean, these are some great words, with the exception of this one here down at the bottom. You know, what will your legacy be? And I'd like to share with you a personal story of how important that is. Because what I want you to start thinking about is, before your career has even started, what will your legacy be? And this is the story I'd like to share with you as far as why I think that's so important. So this is a picture of myself and my grandfather and then my wife. If you can't tell, my grandfather has more hair than me, so that's how he stands out. He's the guy on the right. It's a little embarrassing to have your grandfather at 94 have more hair than you do at 44, but that's indeed the case. How many people within their family have a grandfather, grandmother, uncle, aunt that tells the same story over and over again? Oops. Okay. My grandfather was no exception. And so this is how the story goes, and I think it's really pertinent to this conversation. He would say, "Dave, do you like the company you work for?" I'd say, "Papa," that's what I call him. I said, I love the company I work for. And then he said, do you love the job that you're doing? I said, you know, I do. I really do like it a lot. And then he would say, do you like your leader? And for the most part, I would say, yes. And so this is how the story goes. And pardon the language here, but this is how the story would go from there. I knew it was coming. He said, I worked for Indiana Bell for 40 years. I loved that company. I loved my job. But for 2 years, I worked for this one son of a bitch. And I hated him. He was condescending. He made me not believe in myself. He made me want to quit this job. So I heard this story over and over again. And I'm going to show you how much he hated his boss. In fact, you may have seen that when I was a little quick on the trigger there. Take a guess as who the boss is in this picture. The guy with the X on his face. Yes. I have seen many different variations. My grandfather kept a great chronicle of his life through portraits, pictures, you know, with his personal life, with his professional life. But in this picture, what I've seen in different variations is the guy's face is cut out, his face is folded over. He didn't like this guy. So the last time I heard this story was in the summer of 2011, just a few months before my grandfather passed away. And you know, here's the kicker. When he told that story, he still got tears in his eyes. It was that visceral for him. And take a look at that picture. I mean, what, we're talking circa 1970? We're talking 40 years later, that leader's impact on him still had an emotional reaction. So, just to circle back, what's your legacy going to be? Is it going to be caring, responsive, focused, motivated, fair, organized? Or is it going to be causing tears in individuals 40 years later? ?65% of Americans would choose a better boss over a raise. I know my grandfather would have. And if you've ever had a bad boss, anybody ever had a bad leader? In fact, when I asked you to think of like one word that would describe your leader, just with a show of hands, how many would say that it was negative in nature? Okay, a few, pretty good amount. I was talking about this stat earlier here with Chris. It's really close to this stat. 66% of people leave their jobs because of the leader that they have. It's a significant economical impact on your organization. You're losing great people all the time. Organizations are losing great people every day because of the leadership styles that people employ. So, with that said, you may be thinking, well, I'm going to focus on an organization that has a great reputation. You know, maybe I'm going to focus on an Apple or a Google, and their personality styles are going to match mine. Or maybe you're even thinking Southwest Airlines. I mean, we've all been rated pretty highly as far as a place to work. But I assure you, not everyone here at Southwest Airlines has the same personality, and quite the opposite. So I've been looking for quite some time to be able to share some type of quantitative analysis of why I think it's possible for people with different personalities to still be successful partners in business and in life. And so I came across this earlier this year, and you may not think of this person as a social scientist, but I know that you know them. And of course, I'm talking about no other person but Flo. I bet you didn't think when you got up this morning we'd be talking about Flo, did you? She's holding the snapshot. Has anyone participated in that program before with their car? No? Okay. Snapshot is that thing that plugs into your diagnostic analysis computer in your car. And what it basically does, it reports back to Progressive your driving patterns. You know, so from there, they then decide what will be your rates for insurance. So I have three kids, as you heard about. One is 17, soon to be 18 here, just about a week. We pay a lot for car insurance, a lot. He does not cash flow on the car insurance side, that's for sure. And my wife, Joyce, thought, this will be a great idea for us. We should do this and find out, you know, how much we can lower our insurance rates. So I'm going to show you, the next slide is actually going to show you our real results. I'm not making this up. So I drive a Nissan Cube, or at least I did before my son absconded my car. And then my wife drives the VW Beetle. Now, if you can't see that, it measures hard brakes and it measures rapid acceleration. And you're probably wondering, why am I showing this to you? But as you can tell, there's a little bit of a difference. She brakes hard, 13.5 times every 100 miles. Me, a little less than 5. Now, this is where it really stands out as far as rapid accelerations. When you ride with my wife, Joyce, you better have your seatbelt on. 17.7 times out of 100 miles, she's taken off like a jackrabbit. Me, less than one time. This nails us as far as our personalities. My wife is Mach 2 all the time. Me, I'm slow and steady. We have different personalities, and believe me, that has caused some conflict in our relationship. But this is the deal as far as why I think this matters to you. We have different personalities, but we have the same values. We have the same mission. We've got three great kids. I'm committed to her success, and she's committed to mine. And so, as you begin your career, you're continuing your career, you know, finding that values match is really important. It's super important. You know, when you're in that interview and you think, I don't think I like this leader. If you're scared then, you may want to think about it. Is this a good match for me? Later on, when you become a leader and you're evaluating people, interviewing people, or you're just kind of in the day-to-day dealings of running your business, and you're sensing that who you're leading does not share the same values. If you're yoked with someone who's wanting to go a different direction, yoked with someone who's wanting to go, you know, whose values don't align with yours, it's going to be tough. I guarantee it will not be a pretty picture. So I thought I'd share a little bit about with Southwest Airlines is how we try to make sure that we're gathering individuals into our organization that fit that value statement that I talked about. So here we talk about expectations for employees, and that's the one I want to focus on. That one, I don't care if you're an entry-level employee or you're an executive leader, every single person that's hired at Southwest Airlines is expected to meet that expectation. And the three that I want to focus on are under the Live the Southwest Way. I know the picture quality is a little bit bad there, but we focus on three things when we hire at Southwest Airlines. One is warrior spirit. Are you willing to go above and beyond what's expected of you? Servant's heart. Are you willing to help out your passengers, your coworkers, in what they need to get their job done or to make their day better? And the last one is a fun-loving attitude. At Southwest Airlines, we like to have a lot of fun. We spend more time at work with people that are employees than we do with our own loved ones. So we want to make sure that you're a fun person to hang out with. And in interviews, many times, we've decided not to move forward with someone who has great technical skill, but they don't align with those values. And then we carry that on into our performance appraisals. As you're being evaluated at the end of the year, you're measured on how you're doing that, how well you're doing that. And what we've found is that people who don't match up with that, we hope not they don't become a part of the organization, and those that do start to get weeded out as their performance appraisals move forward because they're not a good match. So, moving on to talking a little bit about leadership, and I think at times it's overcomplicated. And this next speaker in this video that I want to share with you, it's called Lollipop Leadership. I don't know if anybody of you guys ever watched TED Talks, but there's some great videos there. I think Chris uses that once in a while. But some great videos on leadership. And this is from Drew Dudley. And he talks about how we tend to overcomplicate leadership. And really, it's the small things that we do that make a big difference. Varun, can you start that up for us?
How many of you are completely comfortable with calling yourselves a leader? See, I've asked that question all the way across the country, and everywhere I ask it, no matter where, there's always a huge portion of the audience that won't put up their hand. And I've come to realize that we have made leadership into something bigger than us. We made it into something beyond us. We made it about changing the world. And we've taken this title of leader and we treat it as if it's something that one day we're going to deserve. But to give it to ourselves right now means a level of arrogance or cockiness that we're not comfortable with. And I worry sometimes that we spend so much time celebrating amazing things that hardly anybody can do, that we've convinced ourselves that those are the only things we're celebrating. And we start to devalue the things that we can do every day. And we start to take moments where we truly are a leader, and we don't let ourselves take credit for it, and we don't let ourselves feel good about it. And I've been lucky enough over the last 10 years to work with some amazing people who have helped me redefine leadership in a way that I think has made me happier. And with my short time today, I just want to share with you the one story that is probably most responsible for that redefinition. I went to a school on a little school called Mount Allison University in Sackville, New Brunswick. And on my last day there, a girl came up to me and she said, "I remember the first time that I met you." And then she told me a story that happened 4 years earlier. She said, "On my day before I started university, I was in the hotel room with my mom and my dad, and I was so scared and so convinced that I couldn't do this, that I wasn't ready for university, that I just burst into tears. And my mom and my dad were amazing. They were like, 'Look, we know you're scared, but let's just go tomorrow. Let's go to the first day. And if at any point you feel as if you can't do this, that's fine. Just tell us, we will take you home. We love you no matter what.'" And she says, "So I went the next day, and I was standing in line getting ready for registration, and I looked around and I just knew I couldn't do it. I knew I wasn't ready. I knew I had to quit." And she says, "I made that decision, and as soon as I made it, there was this incredible feeling of peace that came over me. And I turned to my mom and my dad to tell them that we needed to go home, and just at that moment, you came out of the student union building wearing the stupidest hat I have ever seen in my life. It was awesome. And you had a big sign promoting Shiner M, which is Students Fighting Cystic Fibrosis, a charity I've worked with for years, and you had a bucket full of lollipops. And you were walking along, and you were handing the lollipops out to people in line and talking about Shiner M. And all of a sudden, you got to me, and you just stopped, and you stared. It was creepy." This girl right here knows exactly what I'm talking about. And then you looked at the guy next to me, and you smiled, and you reached in your bucket, you pulled out a lollipop, and you held it out to him. And you said, "You need to give a lollipop to the beautiful woman standing next to you." And she said, "I have never seen anyone get more embarrassed faster in my life." He turned beet red, and he wouldn't even look at me. He just kind of held the lollipop out like this. And I felt so bad for this dude that I took the lollipop. And as soon as I did, you got this incredibly severe look on your face and you looked at my mom and my dad and you said, "Look at that, look at that. First day away from home and already she's taking candy from a stranger." And she said, everybody lost it. 20 feet in every direction, everyone started to howl. And I know this is cheesy and I don't know why I'm telling you this, but in that moment when everyone was laughing, I knew that I shouldn't quit. I knew that I was where I was supposed to be and I knew that I was home. And I haven't spoken to you once in the 4 years since that day, but I heard that you were leaving, and I had to come up and tell you that you've been an incredibly important person in my life, and I'm gonna miss you. Good luck." And she walks away, and I'm flattened. And she gets about 6 feet away, she turns around and smiles and goes, "You should probably know this too. I'm still dating that guy 4 years later." A year and a half after I moved to Toronto, I got an invitation to their wedding. Here's the kicker, I don't remember that. I have no recollection of that moment, and I've searched my memory banks because that is funny and I should remember doing it, and I don't remember it. And that was such an eye-opening, transformative moment for me to think that maybe the biggest impact I'd ever had on anyone's life, a moment that had a woman walk up to a stranger 4 years later and say, "You've been an incredibly important person in my life," was a moment that I didn't even remember. How many of you guys have a lollipop moment, a moment where someone said something or did something that you feel fundamentally made your life better? All right. How many of you have told that person they did it? See, why not? We celebrate birthdays where all you have to do is not die for 365 days. And yet we let people who have made our lives better walk around without knowing it. And every single one of you, every single one of you has been the catalyst for a lollipop moment. You have made someone's life better by something that you said or that you did. And if you think you haven't, think about all the hands that didn't go back up when I asked that question. You're just one of the people who hasn't been told. But it is so scary to think of ourselves as that powerful. It can be frightening to think that we can matter that much to other people. Because as long as we make leadership something bigger than us, as long as we keep leadership something beyond us, as long as we make it about changing the world, we give ourselves an excuse not to expect it every day from ourselves and from each other. Marianne Williamson said, "Our greatest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our greatest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light and not our darkness that frightens us." And my call to action today is that we need to get over that. We need to get over our fear of how extraordinarily powerful we can be in each other's lives. We need to get over it so we can move beyond it. And our little brothers and our little sisters, and one day our kids, or our kids right now, can watch us start to value the impact we can have on each other's lives more than money and power and titles and influence. We need to redefine leadership as being about lollipop moments. How many of them we create, how many of them we acknowledge, how many of them we pay forward, and how many of them we say thank you for. Because we've made leadership about changing the world, and there is no world. There's only 6 billion understandings of it. And if you change one person's understanding of it, one person's understanding of what they're capable of, one person's understanding of how much people care about them, one person's understanding of how powerful an agent for change they can be in this world, you've changed the whole thing. And if we can understand leadership like that, I think if we can redefine leadership like that, I think we can change everything. And it's a simple idea, but I don't think it's a small one. And I want to thank you all so much for letting me share it with you.
I love that video. Has anyone ever seen that before? No? It's a great video. And it really encapsulates what great leaders do. It's just the small things that you do. But here's the deal. A lot of times, you're not going to know that you've had that positive impact. So as a leader, if you're going into that role just for the fact that, well, I'm going to get a lot of great feedback all the time, you're not. How long did it take before that person came up to him and said, thank you?
4 years.
4 years. So if you're looking at leadership, I'm always going to be getting someone telling me, hey, great job, great job. It's not going to happen. But I think that video shows the incredible power of genuinely caring for others. And some may say, well, that seems a little fluffy. It seems a little soft. Let me share with you another article that I came across that I think also supports that. This is out of Inc.com. 3 steps to becoming an amazing admired boss. Who wouldn't want that? Those adjectives describing you as a leader sometime. Amazing and admired. So Scott tells this story about 20 years ago. He's walking to his car. And during the time he's walking to his car, his leader's walking alongside of him. And she begins talking to him about his personal aspirations. And he writes in this article, he doesn't recall anything about what they spoke about. You know, there was no specifics that he could recall. But he did share this quote as far as what he sensed. He talked about how he was struck with this tremendous power of caring that came from that leader. She cared about him. She cared about his success as he continued on after that conversation. She was invested in him. And he talks about in the article about his tremendous loyalty to her, and that he would have knocked down a wall for her. And it's so funny, I was just in Dallas a couple weeks ago, and I heard a group of leaders talking about another individual, and they were talking about this leader, and a leader said that exact thing, that I know that leader would knock down a wall for me. You know, that sense of loyalty, that sense of caring can be extremely important. And so how do you develop it? Just scheduling regular time to meet with those that you lead. You know, that would seem obvious, but I can't tell you how many leaders don't take the time to do that. They're more focused on the operation. They want to get things done. That's what they view being a great leader is. And I'd say many of them have it all wrong. It's about building great people and having them do the work, having them harness their energy, their passions. But you got to show that you care. And you show that you care by making sure that you know them, that you're committed, and that you're intentionally taking some time to meet with them. And remember, this time is about them. It's not about you. It's not about talking about metrics and how things are going with the different operations. It's about learning about them. And the reason I say that is, you know, you may be dealing with all kinds of individuals. You may be having an employee who's taking care of an elderly parent or has a sick child or has other things going on in their life. And just by knowing that, you can make a big difference for them. Maybe you can be flexible with their schedule. Maybe they can telecommute. Maybe they can do 4-10s. Who knows? But just that knowledge of what's going on in their life, you can make a tremendous impact and build that loyalty. The last one is the one that I think only courageous leaders can do. And it's okay if their future does not include you. I often tell leaders all the time, I'd rather have a star for 3 years than a dud for life. Absolutely. But when you say that, when you are willing to hire stars, you've got to be willing to hire people who have a higher level of expertise than you. You may have to be prepared to hire someone who's smarter than you. And sometimes people aren't that courageous. They want to be the smartest person at the boardroom table. And those are the organizations that are in trouble. Because if you're the smartest one at the table as the leader, you're going the wrong direction. So, whoops, let me back up. I think there's one, before we start that up here, let me just kind of preface that. As we talked about, you probably have gotten the impression that mostly what I'm focusing on is that you're just caring about people. But caring does not equate to not holding people accountable. In fact, that is probably the biggest part of being a great leader is certainly the caring part, but holding people accountable. And sometimes that takes an incredible amount of courage, and that's where I see a lot of leaders fail. They don't want to have that difficult conversation with the person who's not performing their job because they're difficult. Or they know that person has a lot of things going on in their life, you know, with their family, and they say, well, I'd hate for him to lose his job because of that situation. But at some point, when the organization's underperforming, if you're not finding a way to get it to perform, and there's key individuals who are causing that, if you don't address it, your leader will address you. So at some point in time, you do have to have that courage to take action and have those crucial conversations. Has anybody seen the movie We Bought a Zoo? Okay, my kids saw it. Maybe not everybody here has seen that. But what I want to show you is just a short clip. And I think this clip, what it talks about with courage, it's applicable to you as a leader and in your life. And I want you to see it before we move on to the next step.
What happened with you and Lily?
I don't know. I guess I didn't listen to something she told me or something. I mean, I liked her. It's like you embarrass yourself if you say something, and you embarrass yourself if you don't.
You know, sometimes all you need is 20 seconds of insane courage. Just literally 20 seconds of just embarrassing bravery. And I promise you, something great will come of it.
Have you ever had one of those situations occur during the day or the week and it just keeps you up at night? It gnaws at you? You know you should have had that conversation. You think, gosh, I wish I would have said that right then, but you didn't. That's been my mantra, like I said, this past year and having conversations with myself and with leaders, is that sometimes it feels like the more comfortable route to just go ahead and let people be the way they are. Act the way they are. But you really have to kind of push through that initial, you know, desire to just let things be. Because if you don't, they're just going to continue to gnaw at you. You know that something's wrong and you need to move forward. And other people see that too. Believe me, it's not, you know, missed when star performers are seeing their leader not hold people accountable that should be. You know, because of their performance or because of their behavior, when you're not doing that, it is painfully obvious. And they lose respect for you as a leader. They truly do. And you kind of start to lose respect for yourself after a while because you know you're not doing what you need to do. So let me end up with a book recommendation I would advise all of you at some point in time to read as you venture into your careers and as leaders, and it's called Necessary Endings. Now, I know that's not the most motivational quote to probably end up with, but I think it's extremely true. Sometimes a leader, the best thing a leader or anyone else can do is to give up hope in what they are currently trying. All things must come to an end at some point in time. It's true. And as a leader, the sooner that you realize that with some ventures maybe that you're going off on that just aren't turning out like you thought they would, or you have employees that aren't performing like you would think they would, sometimes it's time to end that relationship and begin a new chapter. But it's difficult. So in this book, he draws a parallel with gardening and with leadership. And as a gardener, sometimes you have to prune back branches that are dead, or branches that just aren't thriving, or buds that are, you know, just not what they should be. And then sometimes, as a gardener and sometimes as a leader, you have to prune back branches that are really growing, but they're growing in the wrong direction. And it's difficult, but it's what's needed for the organization's success. So I appreciate this time to be able to meet with you today. If I can leave you with two things, as leaders, please genuinely care for those that you lead. And two, summon up that 20 seconds of insane courage that you need to hold, to have those conversations that are really needed. So thank you so much. I wish you the best of luck.